you go to the ethnic sections in some of these mass channel stores, you'll notice that a lot of times they're not well lit. They're not really nicely displayed and nicely merchandised. It might be a little dark section in the back. And we felt like we don't want to accept that kind of treatment. We've worked too hard, we've come too far, and we represent a body of people that have too much pride in order to accept that. So we were in Target for a long time, and we had to fight in order to stay either on end cap, which is where we are, and not go in line to the ethnic section, or go into the pro section where we feel like we really belong, because the pro section has a salon heritage, and after all, the products really came from a salon background, so it makes sense that we're in the pro section, right? This is a conversation that's been going on, you know, in the boardrooms of big companies, beauty companies, you know, all over. And they still have an antiquated way of thinking in terms of marketing products to black people. And these are products that are usually not even owned by black people. Mm-hmm. All these products that are in the ethnic aisle, they're all owned by white people. Not all. Well, not all. And not all white people. But a lot of them are. I'm just telling the truth. So we really stood our ground, and finally Target really understood, and they gave us an opportunity around 2 months ago to really move us in line. And when you're moved in line, that means when you are gaining a permanent position in a store. They decided to move us in line in 100 Target stores into the pro section. And we thought that was really a cause for celebration, because you know, that positioning of products in the ethnic section, that's been something that's been going on for years, talked about, nothing's ever really been done about it, but finally we were able to take a stand, and we left a lot of money on the table too, because when you're able to operate from two locations versus one, just on end cap, you're able to get a lot more exposure and a lot more sales. But for us, it was important that we really kind of uphold, you know, that commitment that we had to, you know, being a product that is used and is appreciated and respected and prideful.
That was a bittersweet experience for us to hold our ground, because some of our business advisors said, "Do you know how much money you're leaving on the table?" And it was a weird time, because it had already been identified that this is a serious market, and every one of our competitors went into the ethnic aisle. And although this is a labor of love, and although we initially, we came
out. And Pillow Soft Curls is responding to the new curly hair aesthetic. When we originally started, having curly hair was always about having ramen noodle kind of definition to your hair. But now we're seeing that's changed. And women like their hair to be soft and fluffy and bouncy and big and a little undone. This product is going to help you to achieve that look. This is going to be debuted in July 2012.
This product is going to be a lot of fun, because it's our take. We love fabric softener, and we love that, you know, everything is soft. So this is like the first fabric softener-esque product for curly hair. So when you see all the rest of them come after.
And it smells as wonderful as fabric softener does. It's like fabric softener for your hair.
So this is still also a testament to Miss Jessie, because not only was she a great cook, but all her clothes were immaculate and white. And always smelled so good, so she would love this product a lot too. Pillow Soft Curls, coming out in August, early August. Oh, coming out in July.
So we've come to the end of our presentation and what our take has been on natural hair and how the movement started and what our journey has been. And it has really been a long ride to get here. Some people look at us and they think, wow, you guys have it made. You know, you're running a successful company, but you have to understand, it took a lot of hard work, a lot of sacrifice. Miko and I, we've been at this for 15 years working together. You know, it took sacrificing of our early adult years while everyone was out at the party celebrating, you know, being fabulous, you know, during the whole puffy era. We wanted to be there, but we made a choice that we were gonna work hard at our business instead. So, you know, it's gratifying for us to look at the landscape now and see that Miss Jessie has made a contribution, and all the love that we get back from our customers really continues to inspire us. It continues to inspire us to make product. And also, you know, the idea that this product is made specifically for a texture and not an ethnicity is an important stance for us too. So it's one that we feel very proud that we have accomplished, and we really owe all of that to you guys, because without your support, there would have been no way that we could have gotten here. So I want to thank everyone for that.
Thank you.
We're here. We didn't bring any models to do any demos today, but we are here to definitely answer some questions that you might have. And inside of each of your bags, there's a very important brochure, and that brochure is called Which One Is For Me? This is very, very important, because what it does is it breaks down the hair category that you might fall in, and then based on that category, these are the corresponding products that you could possibly use. I think in this room, most people are either in the tight, curly, or the kinky category. And you're probably wondering, well, what's the difference between tight, curly, and kinky? The difference between tight, curly, and kinky is that people that have tight, curly hair are people who can do a wash and go, and that wash and go can last a day or two or three. Whereas if your hair is kinky, generally, you're not open to doing wash and goes. You have to twist and coil your hair in order to get style preservation. So that's really the main difference. If you can just wet your hair, put product in it, you see a curl and that curl stays, you're a tight curly. If you wet your hair, you put product in it, and then 5 minutes later it looked like you didn't do nothing at all to your hair, you're kinky. And it's okay, right? Because we're all different textures.
Yeah, that's right.
We're all different textures. And the great thing about Miss Jessie is that we have a product for every single hair type in here. So I don't know how we're going to do this. I don't know. We're going to take some questions. Maybe if you guys can speak loud enough, we're happy to answer any questions that you might have. You just want to raise your hand. Yes. Well, my advice to you is you're trying to get your hair to look like one texture. If you can't get it in the front, you're going to have to twist it. So if you're twisting, if your hair is tight, if your hair is kinky in the front and tight curly in the back, I would advise you to treat your hair as if it's kinky and twist everything. That would be the way where you can get everything to look consistent. And then at night, ladies, you remember you have to retwist your hair at night. Maybe not in as small sections, but in large sections, because the last thing someone with kinky hair wants to do is sleep on their hair, sweat it all out at night, and then wake up in the morning in a panic attack and wonder what happened. Oh my God, it's gonna take me hours to do it all over again. You can really prevent that by how your hair is cared for at night. And kinky hair really needs to be contained at night, protected styling at night. You should decondition your hair as often as you wash it. So if you're washing once a week, you can decondition it once a week. With our kind of hair, there is no such thing as over-conditioning. There's no such thing as that.
That's good.
And you want to moisturize daily.
Titi!
Unfortunately, singles, she's wondering around about the peppercorn knots that we all get on our hair, right?
Yeah.
Peppercorn knots comes from the texture of the curl pattern, and the way that you can alleviate that is you have to comb your hair out, number one. You comb it while your hair is wet, while you have a deep conditioner in there, in the shower. You want to comb it every time you wash it. Secondly, you want to cut it regularly. My recommendation for cutting hair is you want to cut natural hair twice per year. Any more than that, you won't see any growth. And then thirdly, you have to use a moisturizer on your hair.
See any growth, not because your hair is not growing, only because we have a lot of shrinkage. So that's why we recommend 2 times a year. Because our hair has a lot of shrinkage, we don't recommend that you cut every 6 weeks, because what little bit or what lot bit grew, it's gonna read like it's shorter. So what just grew in, you're gonna cut off the end. So if you want length, which, and I'm a big fan of long hair, if you want length, you want to cut your hair 2 times per year.
Okay, that's good.
And then also, hair that is moisturized and hair that is slippery will have less of an opportunity to want to knot up on you. It's when the hair is dry, you know, when it's not detangled, when the strands are not in alignment, that's a perfect scenario for those peppercorn knots. And baby buttercream and curly buttercream are excellent products for that.
The humidity. I'm from California and I go home quite a bit, and my hair loves California. But I'm married to a Texan, so I live in Texas. And this humidity, wow, because in the winter I can braid it or twist it once a week and it will hold its pattern. In the summer, I'm thinking because of this humidity, I have to do it every night or I rock a fro. And I'm okay with that, because some days I'm fro and some days I'm ringlet. What would you suggest regarding your product works well with humidity?
I think you definitely want to keep moisture on the scene, so I would use 2 products. I would use curly pudding, a little bit of curly pudding, because it has hold factor, and hold factor is really going to keep humidity in check. But you want to also base your hair with the baby buttercream so you keep that moisture. So after you wash it, you put your baby buttercream in first, then a little bit of curly pudding, double strand twisted, and then you'll be able to do 2 things at once.
Okay.
Maintain your style, maintain your curl, and also keep the moisture.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I think also the question you might be asking too has to do with shrinkage and how do you fight shrinkage when you're in humidity.
Exactly.
And the answer to that is that there is no way to fight shrinkage in humidity. You know, if your hair is natural and you come outside and it's all humid, or if it's raining, what's gonna happen? What can you do about that while you're outside in that weather? Nothing. What you can do is you can twist it, but then you wouldn't be able to wear your twist out. You know, so you either just go with it, and that's part of the beauty of having natural hair is embracing the elasticity of it and the unpredictability of it.
Amen.
You know, for some people it's a pain in the neck, but for other people, you know, it's just part of being natural. We have a product called Stretch Silkening Cream, but I think for your daughter, she sounds like she's probably in the kinky category. So for her to wear her curly, her hair out, it's gonna require that you twist it. Twist it and then untwist it. So she should be wearing twist outs in order to wear her hair out. And you can twist it out with baby buttercream. That's a great question, and that's one advantage I think that Miss Jessie's has in this marketplace, and that is that we have a salon. And our salon is really the R&D. I mean, obviously first, when I get a product in from our chemist, I always test it on myself first, test it on each other. Then we'll bring it to our salon, we'll test it in the salon, figure out, you know, different kind of scenarios, and then if it's something that we like, then we go into, you know, small pilot batches, and then if it passes muster there, then we'll go and we'll produce it. But having a salon has been really, really critical for us, and it really helps us to identify what the needs are. So we're not just coming out with product out of the butt just because, you know, oh, it's December, it's time to come out with 5 new products. No, we don't operate like that. We have to identify the need first and then the solution. So problem, then solution. That all the color lines are basically the same. If your hair is very dark, and quite simply, if you want to go light, you're going to have to use bleach. There's no way around that. Now, I think what makes the difference is how this product is applied. I can't tell you how many times women come to the salon and they say, oh, they went and they tried to go blonde and their hair looks orange to me. You know, so you really have to go to a professional that knows what they're doing with color. You cannot go light at home. You cannot buy a box color off of the supermarket shelf, bring it home, you see that the person is blonde on that box and your hair is dark and you're going to put that in and you're going to wonder, how come my hair still looks brown? You know, that's why hairstyling is a profession, and it's one that people really need to take seriously, because you really have to know what you're doing in terms of, you know, any kind of chemical processes. Once you've decided that you want to go light, is that healthy for your hair? Probably not. It's not. But can it be done with minimal damage? Yeah, it can be. I'm a prime example of it. I have a lot of color. I've always had a lot of color. And my hair, for the most part, still holds up, thank God. But, well, that's the professional who does my hair. No, I don't recommend, particularly if you want to go light. If you're going light, you need to go to a professional in a salon. If you're just doing a rinse, meaning you're not really changing the color of your hair, you're just adding a little bit of tone to it, you want to enhance it, you want to go darker, a black rinse, as long as it's not that Beigen, because that's permanent color. A lot of people think it's not just because it's in a powder form. But it's powdered peroxide, you're adding water to it, and boom, then you have permanent color. I would recommend doing any kind of permanent coloring processes at a salon, and a reputable one, because you can still, in this day and age, go to a salon and they don't know what they're doing either. Find a good hairstylist just like you find a good doctor, like you find a good accountant. You go through referrals. If you see someone whose hair you like, don't be afraid to ask that person, hey, where do you go? That's an important way to find a good colorist. The other way to find a good colorist is maybe you can call like an 800 number for Clairol or for L'Oreal and ask them, do they have a teaching salon in the area? Then you know that people are being taught properly and you would possibly get the right job, you know? I think that's probably the best way. The difference between buttercream and pudding is buttercream does not have any hold factor in it. So the result of that is a twist out with buttercream will be a fluffier twist out, whereas curly pudding has a hold factor to it, so it's going to be a little bit more defined, a little bit firmer. So your twists may tend to last a little bit longer if you're using curly pudding.
This lady wants to know, what made me do my big chop? Well, I shared with you guys when I first had my son around, he's 12 now, around 10, 12 years ago. It was just a sign of the times in my life. And now here it is 12 years later. I've seen many women go from short to long. We're still in the salon, so I've grown out a lot of hair. And it was for many reasons, but one of the reasons that really stick out in my head daily is I know how important hair is. I work in the hair industry, but I wanted to know, could I really feel beautiful without my hair? I really wanted to know the answer to that question. And every time I did a big chop in the salon, usually under my breath, and secretly I was like, I want to do that. But here I am, the spokesperson for Miss Jessie's. It's my company, and hair is the name of the game. But I just really wanted to understand, could I feel beautiful without my hair? I know my way around hair, and I know what to do, but you know, without this, what can I hold on to? And I wanted to know what it was like to have no crutches. And my hair, I can rely on it to do what I wanted to do, but now I don't have that. So far, so good. Absolutely. We just opened Miss Jessie's Curl Bar, which is going very well, but it's kind of like our tester pilot format or standard for the extension of Miss Jessie's in other towns, like Dallas and like other towns. And we really kind of simplified our menu so we can deliver it in a more of a standardized way of delivering Miss Jessie's way of approaching curly hair. So now that we have around 15 years under our belt, we know the shortcuts. We know the ways to share our information with other stylists so they can deliver, you know, like-minded work. So we are working on it, and that is the next step for us.
Century. It's time for us to redefine who we be. You can shave it off like a South African beauty. Got it on lock like Bob Marley. You can rock it straight like Oprah Winfrey. If it's not what's on your head, it's what's underneath. And say, hey, I am not my head. I am not your skin. I am not your expectations. No. With the wave cap and the cops wanna harass, cause I got waves. Ain't seen nothing like that in all.